The Ford Escort Cosworth for me is one of those standout performance cars. When I was back just getting into performance cars and modifying engines, this is a car that I always looked up to. We didn't get a lot of them back in New Zealand, but it was always interesting to look to the European market and see what they were doing. And the sort of power figures back then they were extracting out of the YB Cosworth engine was impressive. Of course, times have moved on, and the sort of power they're extracting back in the mid-90s is nothing like what we're seeing now, even in what we consider to be lightly modified street cars. Now, the car behind me is no stranger to social media. This is, of course, Ken Block's heavily modified Escort Cosworth, used for drift demos, for Gymkhana videos, as well as genuine rally use. We thought we'd take the opportunity to dive in and find out what makes this car tick and what they've modified since these cars were released back in the 90s. Interestingly, in terms of the engine itself, there actually hasn't been a lot of development necessary to the base 2-litre YB Cosworth 4-cylinder engine. These are a very stout engine, they were a great performer back in the 90s, and they're still a very stout combination today. One thing that has changed though, the factory cast iron block has been swapped out in favour of a lighter and stronger Smith & Jones engineering casting. This has also been matched with a Smith & Jones cast cylinder head. Now externally they look very similar, and the main differences around strengthening or increasing the thickness of the casting in key areas, allowing in particular with the head, the porting to be optimised without any danger of porting through into the water jacket. The rest of the engine combination is much as you would expect, with high quality top line components including forged crankshaft, pistons and connectors. Rods. Interestingly, with the lubrication system, the car still runs a wet sump. This is quite typical with rally cars due to the fact that, particularly on gravel, they're not generating the sort of lateral g-forces that really require going to a dry sump lubrication system. In this case, the sump is a magnesium casting from Ford Motorsport. It's been fitted with some additional baffles to make sure that the oil control is as good as we could expect with a wet sump system. Probably the two key areas that we've seen advances in over the last few decades have been in turbocharger as well as electronics, and this is definitely one of the areas where the team building Ken's car have really doubled down. In particular, the turbocharger selected is a BorgWarner EFR7670. Now this actually does double duty because the car is run in both unrestricted form, as it is here, running around about 670 horsepower with 2 bar of boost pressure. However, when the car is running in Group A rally trim, it is running a 34mm restrictor. Now this really strangles the airflow in the top end, and what we see here is a boost curve that peaks down at low RPM, around about 3,500 to 4,500 RPM, about 2.3 bar. But as the RPM climbs, that restrictor really strangles the flow into the turbocharger, and the boost is ramped back down. And at 7,000 RPM, the car or the engine is only seeing about 0.5 bar of boost. This is one of the reasons where gearing is so important for a rally stage, and the drivers will be shifting quite low in the RPM, maybe only around 5,500 to 6,000 RPM. The only time the rev limiter is ever seen is when the car is in top gear and the driver really needs maximum speed. One of the interesting aspects with this turbo setup is that it is running an internal wastegate, although we can see that it is fitted with a TurboSmart internal wastegate actuator. Now this is a dual port actuator. This gives the team the ability to get much finer control over the boost pressure. And in an interesting twist here, rather than a conventional 3-port or 4-port boost control solenoid that we'd normally see used for boost control, we can actually see that there are a pair of injectors used. These are fitted to the front cover of the engine. Now the way this is used is that in conjunction with the Cosworth ECU, boost pressure can be fed either to the top of the wastegate, forcing it open and lowering the boost pressure, or alternatively boost pressure can be fed to the underside of the wastegate, trying to hold the wastegate closed, which has the effect of raising boost pressure. Now while this might seem a little bit unusual, this is a technique that has actually been used for years, predominantly in the rally scene. Another area of development that's seen on Ken's car is the inlet manifold. In this case, a Julian Godfrey Motorsport inlet manifold is fitted, fronted with a drive-by-wire throttle body. The way this intake manifold works, we can see that the air actually feeds into the bottom of the manifold and it's then fed up into the body of the plenum chamber. Now the idea here is to make sure that the airflow into each of the four cylinders is as even as possible. And talking to the engine builder, on a restricted tune with a 34 millimeter restrictor, this inlet manifold saw an improvement of around about 20 horsepower. Now in restricted terms, 20 horsepower is absolutely huge. We can see that the inlet manifold is also fitted with a pair of injectors per cylinder. Now this is really nothing new for the YB Cosworth engine, and even back in the Sierra Cosworth days, the RS500 model straight off the showroom floor was fitted with two injectors per runner, although in stock form the second injector was actually disabled. This was an easy upgrade or modification that could be made in the aftermarket. It simply required some wiring and a rechip of the factory ECU. In this case, this is all controlled seamlessly through the Cosworth ECU in a staged fashion, where one of the injectors per cylinder is used at idle and low RPM, and as the boost in RPM increases, the second injector is staged in to match the requirements for fuel flow of the engine. Backing the engine is a SAIDI of 6-speed sequential transmission. This is also fitted with a micro switch to the gear lever assembly so that Ken can upshift without lifting off the throttle. By pulling back on the gear lever, this activates the micro switch, which then sends a signal to the Cosworth ECU. Here, an ignition cut can be employed, which allows the next gear to be selected. Now, because the driver can stay flat on the throttle, this means that the boost doesn't drop off and gives a much more seamless torque delivery through the upshifts. Now, while the car is fitted with a drive-by-wire throttle body, and conventionally we would use a strain gauge on the gear lever, which can then also detect a downshift, allowing an automatic blip of the throttle to match revs. In this case, this is actually handled manually by the driver. Now, I've already mentioned the Cosworth ECU that is used for the engine control, and of course, given modern technology, this is far more advanced than the ECUs that were used back in the days these cars first came out, giving the tuner a lot more flexibility to control the power delivery from the engine using aspects such as gear-dependent boost control and throttle-dependent boost control. The rest of the electronics package also includes a Cosworth power distribution module, which replaces our conventional fuses and relays. This is a much more reliable way of ensuring the power delivery to all of the essential circuits on the car. For a driver display, there is also a Cosworth dash, and this also doubles as a central logging hub so that data from the ECU as well as the chassis can be analysed after a rally or after a Gymkhana demonstration. While undoubtedly technology has marched on in the last few decades, it's great to see that the original Cosworth YB engine is still easily able to hold its own, and it's also great to see this modern technology applied to a modern classic such as the Escort Cosworth.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.